I want you to turn today in your Bible to page 405, 1 Kings chapter 13, page 405 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. And if you don't have an original Scofield Reference Bible, then you need to get you one, because you're losing out on a lot of help and things that can be a blessing to you. And you turn that at page number 405, chapter 13 of 1 Kings. Now, I have here in my hand my book number 3 on Bible questions and answers everyone should know. And on page 6, you'll find the answers to these questions. Jesus only rode 2 things in his life. What did he ride? Where does it say in the Bible that God will spread forth his hands as one that swimmeth? Where in the Bible does it say that the blacksmiths were outlawed from the land? What was the first invention on earth by man? What is meant by Palm Sunday? Who did God say neat after his neighbor's wife like a horse? Who in the Bible said that God curdled him like cheese? And who built the first earthly city? Where does it seem to imply that there might be people on other planets? Where does God say nations are as a drop in a bucket? Who in the Bible commanded his father to be embalmed? What three people 40 days and what people three people fasted 40 days and 40 nights? What 2 verses in the Bible reminds us of a man's suspenders? What is the first living thing God created? Who did God say feedeth on ashes? Where's the first song recorded in the Bible? Where does the Bible imply that hell is in the heart of the earth? What man of the Bible said that God made him a pattern to others? These answers you find on page 6 of book number 3. If you'd like to have this book, write in and enclose a gift of $2 more and request it. We get it in the mail to you. We do have 5 books, and if you'd like to have the 5, it'll be $2 each. Now, if you'd like to have this tape today, it's tape number 358. I'm speaking on the subject, sitting down under an oak. Sitting down under an oak. And you can have the tape number 368 for a gift of $3. And your gift is used to help defray our radio expense. And you write in, get the tape of the book, or like to have a list of our cassette tape. We'll send you a list of more than 350. And pray for us, because this is a faith ministry. And I depend upon you that love God to help us take care of the radio time expense. So my mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. Many of you know that address, so pray for me and write to me. Had a great time last week in Reidsville, North Carolina, in the New Heights Baptist Church in the Jubilee there. On Tuesday night, they had 64 preachers, plus the house filled with other people. And I had the privilege of preaching to that bunch of preachers one day. And then Brother Bert Crawford and his wife went with us up there, and with me and my wife. And Brother Bert got to preach to a great group of preachers and sing a song to them. And it was a great blessing to him. We had a wonderful Jubilee. That's in Brother Harold Venable's church in Reidsville, North Carolina, the New Heights Baptist Church. Appreciate the service you had here on Wednesday night. I understand Tony brought a good message, and we appreciate that. Many years ago, when they had great brush arbor meetings, they'd go out and put up these brush arbors, and then they'd get under them and have a meeting. Many times you could see the stars, the moon through the top. And there's one feller in the meeting each night, he'd stand up and look straight up and say, "I see something." Night after night, he stood up and said, "I see something." Some little devilish boys caught a possum and tied the thing up over his head up there in the brush. He got up that night and looked up and he said, "I do see something." So he really saw something that night. Sometimes you can see things when you don't see things. But it's always good to see the great and wonderful things of God in the wonderful Word of God. So I'm going to read from the scriptures in just a moment. 1 Kings chapter 13, and you follow me as we read the word of God. All right, verse 1. And behold, there came a man of God out of Judah by the word of the Lord unto Bethel, and Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense. And he cried against the altar in the word of the Lord and said, O altar, altar, thus saith the Lord, behold, a child shall be born unto the house of David, Josiah by name, and upon thee shall he offer the priests the high places that burn incense upon thee, and men's bones shall be burned upon thee. And he gave a sign the same day, saying, This is the sign which the Lord hath reckoned, or hath spoken rather, behold, the altar shall be rent, and the ashes that are upon it shall be poured out. And it came to pass when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God, which had cried against the altar in Bethel, that he put forth his hand from the altar, saying, Lay hold on him. And his hand which he put forth against him dried up, so that he could not pull it in again to him. The altar also was rent, and the ashes poured out from the altar, according to the sign which the man of God had given by the word of the Lord. And the king answered and said unto the man of God, Entreat now the face of the Lord thy God, and pray for me that my hand may be restored me again. And the man of God besought the Lord, and the king's hand was restored him again, and became as it was before. And the king said unto the man of God, Come home with me and refresh thyself, and I will give thee a reward. And the man of God said unto the king, If thou wilt give me half thine house, I will not go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water in this place. For so was it charged me by the word of the Lord, saying, Eat no bread, nor drink water, nor turn again by the same way that thou camest. So he went another way, and returned not by the way that he came to Bethel. Now there dwelt an old prophet in Bethel, and his sons came and told him all the works that the man of God had done that day in Bethel. The words which he had spoken to the king, them they told also their father. And the father said to them, What way went he? For his sons had seen what way the man of God went, which came from Judah. And he said unto his sons, Saddle me the ass. So they saddled him the ass, and he rode thereupon, and went after the man of God, and found him sitting under an oak. And he said unto him, Art thou the man of God that camest from Judah? And he said, I am. Then he said unto him, Come home with me and eat bread. Now to conserve time, I'm not going to read further, but you need to read the remainder of this chapter. But if you notice in verse 14 that this man of God, this great prophet, was found sitting under an oak. Now Jeroboam was the first king over the separate 10 tribes. And he set up altars in Dan and Bethel. Jerusalem was God's anointed place for worship. He was afraid his people, of course, would turn back to Rehoboam, the son of Solomon. So they had a split kingdom there. Israel had split off from Judah. And there in Judah, Jerusalem was among the tribe of Judah. But Jeroboam set up an altar in Bethel and in Dan, that the people might go there and worship. There the golden calf or the altar he set up or whatever he set up, there that they might go and worship there instead of Jerusalem. Now Jerusalem was a designated place for God's people to worship. Those Jews knew that. And that displeased the Lord, what Jeroboam had done. And then God sent this prophet from Judah down to bring this message, to preach to the altar, and to do what he did. And there's several things about this that I want to bring out to you today, time permitting. And I want you to notice, after this prophet obeyed God, he did something wrong. And many times when God blesses us and uses us, if we are not careful, we'll do likewise. And what he did wrong, he sat down under an oak. That's the first thing he did wrong. He sat down under an oak. And that led him to do something else wrong that he should not have done, that cost him his life. Now, when you know what God wants you to do, let nobody deviate you from what God wants you to do. You do what God wants you to do, because if God told you to do it, led you to do it according to His word, nobody should deviate your mind and plan away from what God has called you to do. I want you to notice a man of God came to Bethel from Judah. The Bible says in verse 1, "Behold, there came a man of God out of Judah by the word of the Lord unto Bethel, and Jeroboam stood by the altar to burn incense." Now the Bible said this man was a man of God. He was God's servant. He was God's preacher. And when God calls men to preach, then of course they're to preach and preach the word of God. They're God's messengers, and people should hear what they preach and obey the word of God. Not only was he a man of God come to Bethel from Judah, but he was a man with God's message. In verse 1, "There came a man of God out of Judah by the word of the Lord." Every God-called preacher should preach the word of God. Paul said, "Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season." If he doesn't preach the word of God, then he's disobeying God if he's called of God. We have many in the pulpit today, and you know as well as I, that are not called of God, that preach a little social gospel, a little do-better gospel, and don't really preach the whole counsel of God. Now this man came by the word of the Lord. That's the only thing that's going to count when you come to the end of life's journey. Every God-called preacher realizes that. And that's why they want to preach the word, because it's the word that God will use. Not a little social gospel, not a little back scratching and ear tickling, but it's the infallible word of God that God said preach. So he came by the word of God. Number 3, he was a man of courage because he cried against their sins. When this unnamed servant came to Jeroboam and came to the altar, he cried against what they were doing. In verse 2, he cried against the altar in the word of the Lord and said, "O altar, thus saith the Lord." Now it took courage to do that. That was Jeroboam, the leader of Israel. And there he was standing by this altar. And they were worshiping here at an altar of an idol. And so he stood there and he cried against that altar. He cried against what they were doing. Now the man of God should be a man that's willing to speak out and not be afraid to speak out against evil and speak out against that which is wrong. If he's afraid to preach against sin, he'll never mount anything in the ministry. We're to preach against sin. We're to tell people right from wrong and then give them the remedy through the preaching of God's word, that men see their need and see their wrong. Paul said, "I've never known it's wrong to covet unless the law said, thou shalt not covet." And so we need to preach the word of God and tell people what they're doing wrong and then tell them the remedy. Now this man here was a man of courage. Now, it takes great courage today to walk into the pulpit and preach the whole counsel of God. A minister must be a man with a backbone, a man that covers all the ground that he stands on, a man that's not afraid of the faces of people. God can't bless a compromiser. We're living in the days of the apostasy, the days of the falling away, and it takes courage to stand and condemn sin. We have people today being killed on our highways every day, young people drunk riding up and down the highways, and you have a liquor and dope and beer and wine and all kind of sin in the land, and God's men must warn against these things. You have much corruption today being seen on TV and heard on radio. The man of God must warn against these things. He must take courage to do so, have courage to do so, because God expects him to do so. Now this man here cried against their sins. Number 4, Jeroboam laid hold on him. Now when this king or this ruler there in Israel heard the man of God preaching against that altar, he didn't like it. It made him angry. People don't like for you to tell them what they're doing wrong. They don't like for you to tell them that they're not moving according to the word of God. Just the other day, yesterday, I went into the post office, and I believe it was late Friday afternoon. I went into the post office, and there was a man standing there with some of the watchtower literature in his hand. He offered it to me. I said, "I don't want any of that junk." He said, junk. I said, yes, junk. That's out of the pit, fella. I said, you need to find out who Jesus Christ is. Oh, he said, he's the Son of God. I said, yes, but he was very God. Very God and very man. Of course, those poor old Russellites don't believe that. They've been taught an error and shot a curb, and there's no salvation for them in what they believe. All of them's going to hell unless they accept Jesus Christ as God. The Bible said that Jesus is God. They don't believe that. They said he was just a son of God. He was not God. And so I told him that was out of the pit. He didn't much like it, but I told him anyway. And so when I came out, I was going to tell him some more, but I noticed he moved on down the street. He knew I'd be coming out. So he moved on down the street with his poison literature. Now, you got to tell the truth, expose these things. A lot of people don't like it. In verse 4, it came to pass when King Jeroboam heard the saying of the man of God, which he cried against the altar in Bethel, that he put forth his hand from the altar, saying, lay hold on him. And his hand which he put forth against him dried up, so he could not put it again unto him. Now, we find that this king, or this leader here, Jeroboam, laid his hand on the prophet of God. Now, what did God say in the Bible about that? The Bible says in Psalms 105, verse 15, touch not my anointing and do my prophet no harm. It's a dangerous thing to lay your hand on or take a stand against God's anointing. Many years ago, we were going to put up a tent up in the Bogart, and the man that run the plant up there, we had several people in that community wanted us to erect a tent. And I was doing tent work in those days. And there's a beautiful lot out near this plant where this superintendent was in charge, and we wanted to use that lot. And the people wanted us to use that lot. And so we went in and talked with the man about it, and the superintendent became very angry, and he didn't want us to use it. And then he jumped up and turned red in the face, said, you go ahead and use that lot, but if you say anything out there that we don't like around here, then down comes that tent. I shook the dust off my feet and walked out. I wouldn't use that lot under that condition. About a week later, he got drunk and set his couch on fire in a motel over here and burned to death. No doubt died and went to hell. When I heard about it, I thought, now there was a man that opposed us of coming there, and he had the right and authority to let us come. Wouldn't have harmed him in any manner unless exposed his sins. No, he became angry. He knew the people wanted us to come. That's what made him so angry. And so he just died, no doubt, a week later, about a short time later, and went on to hell. You can't lay your hand against God's anointed and expect to get by with it. I can stand here and tell you case after case where that's happened, and God's dealt with a person that laid their hands against God's anointed. Don't you fool with God's men, God's anointed. If you don't agree with them, you better let them alone. Don't do them wrong. Don't mistreat them, because you may have to pay a price for doing so. And so the man Jeroboam, after he saw his hand and withered up when he touched the man of God, his hand withered up. And then that shook him up. He prayed for this prophet from Judah to pray for him. He asked him to pray for him in verse 6. And the king answered and said unto the man of God, entreat now the face of the Lord thy God and pray for me, that my hand may be restored to me again. And the man of God besought the Lord, and the king's hand restored him again, and became as was before. Now, what would you have done in a case like that? Most of them would have said, well, I think I'll just let him go around the rest of his days with a twisted up arm. He shouldn't have laid his hand on me. But the Bible says, do good for evil in a situation like that. And he begged the prophet to pray for him. Jeroboam did. And Jeroboam received prayer. That is, the man from Judah prayed for him. And God restored him back into health again. And so when he did that, then Jeroboam tried to reward him. The Bible speaks about doing good for evil. And we need to realize that many times you can't accomplish things if you're in the will of God by doing good for evil. Won't be like the woman I heard the preacher tell about the other day. He said this woman came to his meeting, and they had sent a bus in the community to pick up people, and she had got right with God evidently, asked she wanted to ride that bus to the meeting, and so she started to leave, and her husband fussed and cussed about it and didn't want her to go and wasn't intending for her to go. He was going to stop her. But she came on to the meeting anyway. She went up and told the preacher how her husband opposed her coming to the meeting. He said, "Well, did he finally agree for you to come?" She said, "No." So I just picked up a frying pan and knocked him out and left him cold in the floor and come on anyway. Well, you don't usually win people, you know, exactly like that. And so, but she laid him out with a frying pan. Well, we find that Jeroboam here wanted the man of God to pray for him, and he prayed for him. The Bible tells us God healed him. But something happened there, verse 7. "And the king said unto the man of God, come home with me, and refresh thyself, and I will give thee a reward." Now, when the devil sees he's licked, he'll try to be your buddy. Better watch about that. When the devil is licked, when you have a problem in your life, you try to get something done for God, and the devil sees he's defeated, then he'll be your buddy. Man, he'll be so friendly toward you and so lovey-dovey and try to make you think he's the best friend you got. He wants to join up with you and agree with you when he sees he can't defeat you. Now, be careful about that. Now, this king said here, "You come home with me, and refresh yourself and rest, and I'll give thee reward because, man, you heal my arm. And if you'll just come home with me, we'll fix you a good meal, good refreshments, and I'll give you a good reward if you'll go home with me." So here we find the devil trying to buy him over and trying to line up with him and trying to reward him. If you're not careful, the devil will try to buy you over. If you got conviction, you need to stand for God and stand by your conviction and let not the devil buy you over. And he'll become your friend and buddy if you're not careful. Then our next thought is this: the man of God refused to be bought. Look at verse 89. "And the man of God said unto the king, if thou will give me half thine house, I will not go in with thee, neither will I eat bread nor drink water in this place. For so is it charged me by the word of the Lord, saying, eat no bread, nor drink water, nor turn again by the same way thou camest." See, God had already told this man, this prophet, this young prophet, what to do. Said, "You go down there and don't eat and drink with them. Don't hobnob around with them, and don't come back the same way. You come back a different way, and don't fool around with that crowd. You carry them the message, do the job, and then you come on back." And so he said, "God told me what to do." Now there happened to be an old apostate, an old preacher that had been laid on the shelf, maybe a false prophet that God hadn't used probably, maybe in years if he'd ever used him at all. And he had some sons. They might have been young ministers, and they saw what had happened. They saw how that Jeroboam had his arm healed, how this preacher had preached against what they were doing and preached against the altar. They run home. They said, "Party, you know what's happened?" Said a young preacher come in down at the altar, and he preached against that altar. And then Jeroboam reached out to take hold on him, and his arm withered up. And then Jeroboam asked him to pray for him, and he did. His arm straightened out again, became healed again. And he said, "A very strange fellow, unusual fellow." And this old apostate said, "Which way did he go?" Verse 11 through 13. "Now there dwelt an old prophet in Bethel, and his sons came and told him all the works that the men of God had done that day in Bethel, the words which he had spoken to the king. Then they told also to their father, and their father said unto them, what way went he? For his sons had seen what way the man of God went, which came from Judah." Verse 14. "And he went after the man of God." Whenever the old prophet found out which way he went, his boys said, "Paul, you ought to have been there." Said, "I'll tell you, that man really preached. He wasn't afraid of anything." And the old man, probably a little jealous, thought, "Well, I don't appreciate any young preacher coming in this area preaching like that. I'll find out what happened to him, where he's going, and I'll overtake him." And so he took off after the young prophet. Now, God said for the young prophet not to remain, don't go in their houses, eat, drink, don't hobnob around, and go a different way and come right on back home. But my text is in verse 14. The old preacher, the old prophet, found him sitting under an oak, and went after the man of God and found him sitting under an oak. Now there's danger after you've done the will of God to sit down under an oak. Now that's my text. What do you mean, Preacher Edwards? I mean when God has blessed you and when God has used you, when God's given you talent and ability to do what he wants you to do, then don't quit and sit down under an oak. Don't sit down and do nothing for God. This man sat down under this oak tree, and he should have stayed on the move for God. Not idle minds, the devil's workshop. While men sleep, the devil sows tares. And when you let any little thing keep you away from the house of God and let up, that's when the devil is going to work on you. You have a lot of backslidden church members today. They let anything come along and keep them out of the service of God. They got to go to grandma's reunion. They got to have a big gathering. They got a fix for the family. Anything can come along and keep them out of the house of God. Why? Because they love those things more than they love the house of God, more than they love the word of God, more than they love the presence of God. And when you sit down under an oak and you compromise, you sit around and sit at home when you ought to be in your church hearing the word of God, you're sitting down under an oak. And if you're not careful, here will come the devil and defeat you. He'll discourage you. He'll do everything he can to hinder you. And he'll rob you of your joy and your power. And you'll be ruined before you realize it. Now, you need to be faithful in serving God. And let nothing stop you and hinder you from serving the Lord. And so this man sat down under an oak. He shouldn't have done that. If he'd have kept on moving, probably the old apostate would have never overtaken him. The devil couldn't have worked through this man and caused him the great problem I'll tell you about in a moment. He sat down on an oak. So I want you to keep that in mind. This is my text. This is what I'm preaching on, sitting down under an oak. I want that to ring in your ears. After you've served God and sitting down under an oak, letting up. Many people, whenever they get past middle age, they let up. And that's when you ought to walk closer to God. The older you become, the more faithful you ought to be. You ought to serve God. And many people just let up and fail to do for God what they once did. You're sitting down under an oak. That's bad. That's wrong. The older you become, the more faithful you ought to be in serving God. Faithful in Bible study, faithful in prayer, faithful in attending God's house for worship, faithful in supporting God financially, faithful in witnessing, faithful in serving God. Now, if you've done all you can do, you need to say, like the Bible said, I'm an unprofitable servant. I've only done my duty. I haven't really done anything for God. You ought to stay busy like that to the glory of God and take that attitude. Then we find again, he was lied to and deceived by the old prophet. In verses 14 through 19, I won't read that, but you may because time won't permit me get it on the air. And so I won't read it, but you ought to read it. Now this old prophet said to him, an angel told me to come here and tell you that you're to come back to my house and I'll give you some refreshments. You're to have a meal in my house. Said the angel told me to come and tell you that. Now listen here, this is a subtlety of the devil. If God told this man what he wanted him to do, and he came and did it, then couldn't God have told him if he wanted him to go back and eat? God told him not to do that. God plainly said, don't go back and eat in their houses and associate with them. And the old preacher said, well, the angel came and told me that God had changed his mind and he wanted you to come back to my house and have a meal with me. Well, this preacher was a young preacher. And many times, are you listening? I'm not preaching to preachers today, but there's a principle involved here. Many times, a lot of old preachers that God's laid on the shelf, that hobnobbed around and played about and compromised, and God laid them on the shelf, And they'll go to a young preacher and tell him how he ought to do it. Now, I'm old preaching, and this is the way you ought to do it, young man. And you do what I tell you to do, and you'll be all right. Now, if God called that young man to preach, God's able to tell the young man what to preach and where to preach and how to preach. Now, most of those fellows have been laid on the shelf. The compromise is sold out. They hobnobbed around, and God just laid them on the shelf. And yet many of them have influence over a young preacher. Now, I'm talking about these old apostates that's on the shelf. I'm not talking about a true man of God. A real true man of God won't lead a young preacher wrong if he's a true man of God. But this man was not a real true man of God, been used of God, and he influenced that young man to come back and go home with him. And the young man listened to him. He thought, well, now this is an old prophet. Why, he's an old man, and he's been a prophet for many years. And the angel must have come and told him, and God probably changed his mind, so I'll just go back and at home with him and eat with him. And he went back to the man's house and sat down and ate his food, and they talked and carried on a while. And then he got ready to leave. He left and took off. But as he started down the road, a lion, which is the type of the devil in this case, the Bible said the devil goeth about as roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. There was a lion that came and attacked this young preacher and killed him. Didn't harm his donkey he was on, but killed the preacher. And he lay there in the road. And so people came by and saw his donkey still standing there, and the preacher's dead. The lion was still there, and the lion killed him. That lion's a type of the devil. See, this preacher sat down under an oak, disobeyed God, and it cost him his life. And when the old apostate heard about it, he took off down to see if it's really true. And sure enough, there lay the preacher in the dirt. There on the ground, the lion had killed him. The donkey's still there. The lion is still there. People gathering around. But the young preacher was dead. And the old apostate, he realized what he had done. And he made this mistake and lied to this young preacher and told him an angel had spoken to him. Paul said, if an angel from heaven preached to you another gospel, which you have not received from me, said, don't you listen to him. Paul said, I got God's message from heaven and the gospel from heaven. Don't let an angel come and tell you any different. If you do, let him be accursed. Don't listen to him. And this man said, an angel had told him that, and he lied. Angel hadn't told him that. And he lied to this young preacher. He listened to him. And the point I want you to get is when you are saved and you are serving God and you're in the will of God and you're doing what God wants you to do, don't you listen, Tom, Dick, and Harry. You talk to God. It's all right to counsel with your pastor or some other Christian about things and pray about things. But if you know what God wants you to do, you better do that. Do what God wants you to do. Now, this young preacher, had he obeyed God, he could have been alive and gone on back home, but he disobeyed God. Now, listen to me. If God told him in the first place, I want you to go down and preach against that altar, and then when you do that, you return back home another way, and don't you go down and hobnob with them people, have nothing to do with them. You go preach and you come back to Judea. Now, had he done that, he'd have been alive. But if God told him to do that, had God Almighty wanted him to go back and eat with this old apostate, then God could have told him that also. But God didn't tell him that. God didn't change his message. God didn't change his command. This fellow lied to him, and it cost him his life. Now, you be careful about how you let the devil lie to you. And if you won't sit out under an oak and sit around on a stool of do-nothing singing, I shall not be moved, then maybe the old prophet won't have a chance to overtake you. You serve God. Stay on the move for God. Stay in service for God. Love the Lord with all your heart. Now, this man here, it cost him his life because he sat down under an oak. Don't sit down under an oak. When God uses you, keep on the move. Don't let up. When you let up, you open the door for the devil to come in. When this man let up, this old apostate came in and deceived him, and it cost the young preacher his life. So don't sit out under an oak. When God bless you and use you, you stay on the move. Don't let any grass grow under your feet. Be faithful to God and serve God. A lot of people, let up, I know people today, they say they're saved. They say they love God. In days gone by, you see them in God's house on Sunday night. You don't see them there now. Where would you find them now? Out riding around, visiting neighbors, looking at TV, gadding about. Why aren't they in the house of God? They're sitting under an oak. They let up. They don't love God like they used to. They don't care anymore. I let the doors become closed on Sunday night. For as they concern, let sinners go to hell. They're not going to come and keep the doors open. They're not going to stand by their pastor and help him win souls and pray for them. Not going to do that. They're going to sit down under an oak, and sooner or later, it's going to cost them a tremendous price. Stand to your feet. Father in heaven, I pray today that you'll take the message and use it. God, help us not to sit down under an oak after you've spoken to us, but to go on and do what you tell us to do. And I pray you'll have your way in this auditorium today and have your way out in the radio listening audience. Speak to somebody out there, Father, I pray today with this message. I speak to our hearts here in the auditorium. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Deb is going to play for us, and as she plays for us, then we'll receive you if you want to come forward. Would you obey God? God wants you to come, then you come. If you want to get saved, come back to God, join the church. If you want Northside to be your church home, would you come?